Hey everybody, how are you? It's Jeff Gelman and Joelle, and this is the episode number 2 of Real Talk with Jeff and Joelle, where we start spending a little bit more time on either single subjects or on a couple of different subjects. We can go in a little bit deeper than we do on a normal Q&A about all different topics. So today's episode, we want to talk about remote power training. So what I'd like to do first is I would like to start talking about dispelling some of the falsehoods that are out there, because there's a lot of falsehoods that are out there when it comes to remote power training. So, Joelle, what are some of the things that you hear that are absolutely just wrong?
Where do I even start?
Right at the first thing that comes to your mind.
It's a shortcut. It's for lazy people. Mm-mm. It'll ruin the relationship with your dog. It'll make the behaviors worse. It'll make the dog lose its trust in you. I mean, I could go on forever.
Right, right.
It's endless.
Right. I think, you know, a lot of, you know, well, if you're trained right, it's good. Or
if you use them properly.
Right. If it should be the last resort, not the first resort.
Yeah.
It's only for aggressive dogs. The biggest ones are it ruins the dog.
And another one that's like, you need professional help.
Right.
You must see a trainer.
Right.
As if dog owners are just that uneducated.
Right.
That they can't just do it themselves.
Right. Right. So let's start breaking some of that down a little bit. So I've been training dogs for 20 years. And for 17 of those years, I've been remote power training dogs. So we're at about 10,000 dogs. And I've seen everything from cute little puppies, but we specialize in really, really badly behaved dogs. But we also have happy-go-lucky, unruly dogs. So they're not just for, quote-unquote, bad dogs. They are for creating good behaviors and eliminating unwanted behaviors and dangerous behaviors. So a lot of people see on our social media, they see a lot of the intake sessions. The intake session, if you're new to us, is we'll have the owner with the dog, and they will be sitting down on the couch, and you'll see the dog's behavior. But I think the latest one is the latest dog that came in.
Cora. The kind of Corsa.
Right. So I would say 99%, if not higher, of these dogs have never been on a remote collar. So all these dogs are highly aggressive, very nervous, massive separation anxiety, no obedience, biting their owners, biting people, getting into dog fights, biting family dogs, nonstop barking, destroying stuff in the car, destroying stuff in the house, breaking out of crates. Like, just name every bad behavior that's possible for a dog. These dogs are doing, and they've never been on a remote collar. So theoretically, if you want to play a funny game, not using a remote collar creates bad behavior. Because if you want to throw saying that remote collars create, it's like we can throw that right back. Mm-hmm. And what's this? What's the study on this? 17 years in 10,000 dogs, and that's just us. Now, there's also many, many, many of our colleagues around the world who are using them. So I'm sure. I mean, in the UK, where they're trying to ban, remote collars, I believe the UK has got 300,000 people using remote collars, and like that's a country that actually, you know, shames on them. Yeah. So the United States, there's a lot, and I know that there's a lot of countries that ban them, but there's also countries that also ban firearms, don't let women drive, don't let women vote, don't have equal rights. They're big, and you know, we can go down the list of, you know, you really can't compare country to country. I think that's really, really unfair. So remote collars are not the only way to train a dog. There's many ways to train a dog. You can get a dog to do a lot of great stuff on the plus side, as well as eliminate stuff without a remote collar. People have been doing it for years. But the benefit of a remote collar is it gives the owner leverage. So if you got a softer owner and a harder dog, it's going to give the owner leverage. So let's talk about a couple of great things. The favorite thing I like about remote collars, I think, is I like to tell people that this is a communication device. it's, I compare it to almost is you have got a headset in your ear and you are X amount of feet, miles away from, you know, command post, and somebody is like telling you what to do and you can hear them. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Because they do have remote collars that actually go up to 8 or 9 miles away. The average one that we use is goes to half a mile, but it's standard that there's remote collars that go to a mile away. I think that's fantastic. And you can whisper or shout with them. Now, that's my favorite thing about a remote collar is we're able to teach a dog a language that they understand. And we'll go into the process of that because it's not a quick fix. And what a great way to communicate with your dog. Also, people need to understand that just because a dog has a remote collar on, that doesn't mean it's like activated.
Yeah.
It's not like in use. It just sits there. Like just because there's a gun in your holster, that doesn't mean you're using it.
Right.
Or airbags in your car. So I love the fact that if you need it, you can have it. And the way we train is we rarely need it once the dog is trained. So that's my favorite thing. What's your favorite thing about remote collars?
Yeah, just the reliability and the consistency factor. I think there's a lot of dogs out there who their owners probably do think they have a very well-trained dog until that one time that dog maybe runs into the road or chases an animal into the woods. And then what? So it's like, even if you do have a very highly trained dog, they all can benefit, I think, from remote collar training. It gives you the ultimate control and peace of mind.
Yeah. I think it's important. We're going to talk about the proactive side of training. We're going to talk about the obedience side and the stopping of unwanted behavior side. And I think it's important that people understand when you do apply a correction, it's, you're never mad or upset or angry, frustrated. It's just, you're neutral. I think the great thing about a remote collar is if you've got a softer owner, but a harder dog, the remote collar is fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, also, we are not seeing dogs messed up. I've seen one dog in my career that was actually messed up by one. You know, I would say most of our clients and who are not using them yet, but clients that I meet, like say at a seminar and our social media audience who has already started it, we're not seeing people misuse them. The biggest thing we see, especially at seminars, is people are underwhelming their dogs. They're underwhelming your dogs. Now, one of the things that a lot of people say is it's a quick fix. And Joelle is going to go over how we actually obedience train a dog. It actually takes theoretically almost twice the amount of work that we do without a remote collar to get a dog remote collar trained, because the way we train is we have to train the dog first, you know, off the remote collar, and then we layer the remote collar, you know, on it.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about also about relationship. So I would say that again, of all the people that come in for dog training, most of these people have a really crappy relationship with their dogs. Like all those things that I described, that's not a dog you can have a good relationship with. Now, does it cuddle with you on the couch? Does it have its great moments? Of course it does. Absolutely. But I want to take my dog everywhere. I want to take my dog around lots of people and lots of dogs. And I want my dog to listen to me. And I lead an off-leash lifestyle. But you don't need to have an off-leash lifestyle. Remote collars are not just for off-leash training. You know, they're also for on-leash training.
Mm-hmm.
Because why? It actually can become the least invasive way to train a dog at some point once the dog understands. It actually literally is, again, a communication device. Now, there are crummy ones. I mean, there's a couple that we use. We use them from Eth Collar Technology and Dogtra. There are a couple of other brands that are decent, but there's also a lot of brands that are not good. Now, one of the biggest rumors is also, or falsehoods is outright actually unethical, especially when vets always say this, is the remote collar burned the dog.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe you're using it at too high of a level. It's like, first of all, remote collars are not burning dogs. If you see any redness or irritation, it's most likely a pressure sore. And you absolutely should be rotating your collars every 3 or 4 hours so you don't get pressure sores. If you left a remote collar in the same place for probably 2 to 3 days, I could see two little things that are pressing up against a dog's neck, no matter what they are. They could be attached to a flat collar. You can take the contact points and attach it to just a flat buckle collar, and it's not a remote collar anymore, and it would do the exact same thing.
We've had dogs come in who wear martingales 24/7
with irritation.
Their necks are raw.
Raw, right. Fur is gone. Fur is missing.
Yeah.
Necks are raw. And same with harnesses.
Being in the same place for too long of a time is going to cause irritation.
It's going to cause irritation. Right. It's just like, that's just the way it is. So I think there's so many falsehoods out there. Also, there are a lot of folks out there that are training, nobody in specific, that says they're promoting is, you know, we just use low levels. And I'm like, that's a marketing. I think it's important that the consumer understand that that is a marketing thing. That is a marketing thing. Low levels don't mean anything to a dog when it's in drive.
No.
So there are many dogs that work, let's say, on single digits, but say when they're in drive, maybe chasing something, they blow through 100 easily. And anybody that knows anything about drivey dogs understands that concept. So for a trainer to put a limit on a number that you should use is unethical, because it's not, you can't compare it to the dog or the situation.
The dog will always tell you the level that's appropriate. And
right.
By putting caps on it, I think it just keeps owners stuck.
That's what we see all the time.
All the time.
Right.
They'll be like, my dog was trained. I did go to a board and train. I did work with a trainer. And we're like, okay, have you ever actually given your dog a proper correction?
Right, right.
Like, well, right. I never went above this number.
Right, that's the problem. Now, also, it's important to know that most dog trainers, they might be able to work on lower levels with a dog, but they're dog trainers. But owners have a different type of relationship with the dog, which sometimes doesn't mean it's a better relationship. It's actually more of a toxic, I behave bad around my owner relationship. So at the beginning, they might have to go to a higher number. But we're not talking about forever. We're just talking about, like, you need to have that conversation. You need to sit your dog down. You don't do this, obviously, but sit your dog down and have a really firm conversation. So that's what the higher number is going to do. So then a lot of people will say, you know, don't train with pain. So can remote collars be uncomfortable? Of course they can. Well, that's the benefit of them too. There's a time and a place, but so can a slip lead. I know many dogs that have passed out on walks, pulling on a slip lead, on a martingale, yeah, on a flat buckle collar. I've seen many dogs in harnesses pull their owners, you know, down and drag them and hurt them. Now, no tool is going to stop that. You know, it's not as easy as pushing buttons. I think that's what people need to understand. It's not a remote control for a television. Now, well, when we start talking about behavior mod later in the show, we will talk about there is a time and a place literally just to give a high correction that doesn't take much training at all. And that's for, like, stopping certain things, and we'll get more into that. So are there anything off the top of your head before we go into obedience that you can think of that we want to address?
I feel like we just went on all over the place, but
it's okay.
I think that's it.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot we could talk about hours just about that without even getting into training.
Yeah.
So why don't we talk about our obedience program on how we train dogs for obedience on the remote collar. And this is all in our actual Green to Graduate program. So in the description, the link to the Green to Graduate will be on there. And it literally shows step by step how we train dogs they don't know any commands, and they're fully off-leash trained. So why don't you explain, how do we get a dog that knows no commands to be off-leash trained on a remote collar?
Well, believe it or not, before remote collar training, there's a lot of training, and we don't use remote right off the bat. Some trainers do, that works for them, great, keep doing it. But with us, we prefer to put a foundation on the dog first.
Right, right.
So we'll spend anywhere from 4 to 7 days, depending on the dog, just working on fundamentals with a leash and a collar.
Right.
Before that dog ever even feels remote for obedience.
Right.
No.
I think it's important that people understand it's like that's all we do all day is train dogs. So for an owner, it might be longer than 4 to 7 days. But right. But when that's all you do all day long.
Yeah. And we're putting devoted time into it in session after session after session.
Right.
But that's our window. But anyway, we spend about, we'll say, give or take a week putting really solid obedience on that dog where whether it's wearing a prong collar, a slip lead, or no leash, it knows its obedience.
Right.
And we make sure it fully knows its obedience because we proof it before we move on to remote collar right. training.
And there's a lot of food involved as well. A lot of
food.
Right. It's typical, you know, reward-based positive reinforcement training that we're doing. And there's it's all food-based if the dog will take food.
Right. And then after we get to that point where the dog is fully verbally compliant and knows every single command, it's doing it when we say it. It's not confused or it doesn't need help. It doesn't need body cues. Like we really proof these guys before moving on to e-collar. And then we start our e-collar training, which in itself is a 3-part program. So the first thing you have to teach the dog is escape conditioning, which is how do I shut off the pressure? It's super low levels. Most dogs work anywhere from a 2 to a 6, let's just say on average, out of 100 levels. Mm. And we have to teach it all one at a time for every obedience command. So now we can't just throw all this new stuff at the dog and expect it to understand. You're teaching a new language, technically.
Right.
So we've been teaching the dog all its commands verbally along with leash pressure. But now when you're talking about e-collar pressure, that's a new foreign language. So we have to actually go all the way back to kindergarten all over again.
Right.
We're literally adding in way more steps into the training process. Whereas if we were just doing leash training, we'd be like, okay, we're done. But now we're adding more steps. So we usually teach one command at a time on remote just to make it that much easier for the dog. We don't want to confuse them. We don't want to make it too hard. We don't want to push them too much because they're in kindergarten, remember. So what we do is we start with one command at a time. We usually start with like place, something in motion, recall maybe. And we have to do priming, which is like you're doing one session of that specific command just so the dog knows like, okay, right now in this moment, we are working on the place command. Mm. We're not doing anything other than place. That's how easy we want to make it for them. The picture is always going to look the same. We're working on place. And then we introduce our remote on super low levels and we take the word away, and that throws a lot of people off. They're like, why would you take the word away if the dog doesn't understand like what you want?
Right. Right.
Because we're not teaching a word. We're not teaching a command in the moment. We're teaching a behavior with the remote.
Right.
We don't actually want the dog to listen to our words in that moment. We just want them to feel the stim and offer the behavior.
Right.
And that's how we know that when they feel that low level stim, they know what behavior to offer.
Right.
And that means they actually understand
right.
the conditioning of the remote.
But it's not that we just stand there.
No, we're helping.
And just pushing a button. Right.
We're helping them a ton. We're using body. We're using food. We're taking them back to kindergarten.
Right.
Just like if we were teaching them leash work.
Right.
In the beginning.
Right.
And
the reason why we don't use the word at the beginning is because did you listen to the remote or did you listen to the verbal command? And we're trying to get these dogs to be proficient on the remote. Also, there's a lot of people that see a lot of our videos and they'll see us training at the training center, maybe 5 feet away from a place bed. And every once in a while, we'll get a comment saying, well, you don't need a remote collar for that. I agree. Mm-hmm. You don't, but we're not training for being listening inside of a training center or a house. We're training for the real world outside.
Yep.
We're training for eventually high levels of distractions, lots of people, lots of possible stress on the dog, not because of any of the tools, but because of the world out there and also a lot of distractions. And we want the dog to actually listen to us. So the best place to start that is in a quiet area.
Yep. So once the dog understands escape conditioning for every single command, one at a time, like we hit that button, dog runs and does whatever command we're working on, we can start introducing like lower level distractions at that point. And then we want to make sure if the dog steps out of command, when it feels stim, does it go back? And then we're like, okay, cool. You're ready to move on to now the next stage,
right.
Which is non-compliant stim.
So what's the first stage called CS.
We call that continuous stim or escape conditioning. They're the same thing.
Right.
And then we have, now once they have that, you move into avoidance conditioning where the dog's actually learning to avoid that e-collar, which is what you want. You don't want a dog that's always being prompted. That's only going to work if it feels stim.
We see that a lot.
We want dogs to work for verbal.
Right.
And then your e-collar just becomes your what if button.
Right.
So this is their first introduction to it in the NCS stage or non-compliance stim, where we now add our word back in and we give the dog a chance. Place. Dog's like, I'd rather like stare at that thing over there. Okay, then pressure goes on at working levels. We are not correcting the dog at this point.
Right.
We're still on continuous working levels, just like we were teaching them in the stage prior. It's just a reminder. It's like, hey, go do what you're supposed to do. And they're like, oh, yeah, right. And guess what? They still get rewarded. We're still using food because they're still figuring it out.
Right.
So even though I had to remind you with a remote, I'm still going to pay you.
Right.
You're still like in kindergarten technically.
Yeah.
But now we're giving them a chance. The dog understands now. Oh, I'm actually in control of this remote. I control whether or not I feel it,
right?
Whether I listen or not.
Right. And it's like this concept of, you know, there's a lot of people that say, well, the dog's only doing it because it doesn't want to get shocked. I'm like, well, there's so many dogs out there that will only work for food. We see that all the time. We see dogs coming into us. Owners know this too, where you'll give your dog a command. It doesn't do anything, but then you reach your hand into your treat pouch and the dog immediately does it. So it's like, well, your dog actually, that means your dog knows the command and blew you off.
But I think even more importantly though, is like, if the dog's only doing it because it doesn't want to be shocked. It's like, first of all, we're not shocking the dog.
Right.
We're working at the lowest levels. Like, what's the difference? I see so many owners out in public where their dog's acting a fool and they're dragging it back with a leash or pulling it down into a down. It's like remotes do it technically less invasive than
way less invasive.
So right. I think that's where people get, you know, misconstrued. Oh, we're shocking the dog into compliance. We're literally just having a conversation with the dog.
Right.
It is no different than using a leash.
Right. I think it's important that people understand also, if we didn't do that first non-remote collar training, the concept that if you give an untrained dog a command, like down, and you just pushed a button and corrected it, it's going to all of a sudden go into a down. Chances are
no sense.
It'll climb all over you or run away.
Freaked out.
Right. Exactly.
I feel like that's sadly, like that's how society looks at e-collar training.
That's the narrative.
You didn't listen, so I'm just going to nail you on a remote.
Right. Like, that's the narrative.
I don't know where this information comes from, but it is literally not what I would say 99% of e-collar trainers are doing.
No. First of all, the dog won't be trained.
No.
It won't be trained.
It's just going to hate the e-collar.
Right. So it's like, I personally don't know anybody that's doing it.
You're just going to mess up your commands. If you say down and then correct your dog, guess what? You just made down a negative marker.
Right.
Your dog's going to be afraid of the word down.
Right.
We want our commands to be a positive thing.
Right.
So that's why we're using low levels in the beginning, because we want them to want to do it. And we don't immediately get on that button. It's not down and stim at the same time. It's down. I'm going to give you a chance, reward you if you do it. And then if not, I'll give you a little reminder.
Right.
And you'll still get paid.
Right.
But it's not down, like shock. Like this whole shocking the dog thing is strange. Maybe, I don't know.
Well, it's from a it's just a well-organized marketing campaign that obviously is against the remote collar. So they come up with the most wildest things. And then they also talk about abuse in the same conversation. And then they also, all the things at the beginning that we talked about, what it's not, that's all in the narrative. But the people that are in the trenches doing the work, like, we don't see that. Like, all these things that supposedly happen, we just don't see.
No. And that's like, it's like, when is the conversation going to start turning? Because I see a lot of trainers out there talking about it and educating people, but for some reason, it's still such a sticking point for so many people.
It makes an easy target. It makes an easy, once someone throws the abuse thing at you, or, it's so easy to drum up a false narrative that it sounds great. So I think trainers in general need to start speaking up more on it. I mean, frankly, the manufacturers need to do a better job and put a little bit of money behind some marketing on it, or financing, you know, technically a YouTube show on how dogs are remote, you know, e-collar technology, Dogtra. They should have their own, you know, YouTube shows on literally how, and let them hire whoever they want that they, you know, that they feel is capable of doing it, and literally make a show on it and dispelling a lot of these, you know, rumors. But for some reason, they are just in the product business instead of the education business. Now, they do have videos on their websites, but I think they can be doing a much, much, much better job. Now, we're doing what we can. We've been talking about it publicly. I've been talking about it publicly for 17 years, whether it's been through social media or the podcast or my radio show back in the days, I've been talking about it.
But you're talking a lot on your shows about the punitive side of remote.
Because that's what people ask.
People need help with. Right. So again, though, that doesn't necessarily,
you know,
shine a good light on e-collars.
Right. Right. I talk a lot about corrections because nobody's asking me.
Right. How
can,
do I train?
Can you take me through? Can you take me through all the steps to get my dog to be doing a really good down? Nobody calls into the show and asks about that. So that's one of the great things about this, you know, the real talk right now. We get more time to talk about these single subjects, which I'm really just really, really excited about.
Mm-hmm.
And then also what we're doing is we put a program together called Green to Graduate, and it's on our academy, and it'll be in the description of this. And you can actually literally take your dog, you know, through the steps. So then after a dog now gets to non-compliant stim, explain some more examples and the length of time a dog is actually on the NCS stage and where we want them to be before we even consider corrections with a remote collar.
So during NCS, that is when we start really proofing those dogs. We're getting out in the real world. We're introducing, you know, the 3 Ds, distance, distraction, duration. And the way we want that stage of training to look is pretty much the dog is going into command on verbal cue pretty much every single time. You know, we say place, dog runs to the place bed. We recall, dog recalls. And then if they're doing almost too well, we have to like, okay, at some point we're going to start proofing this dog. So we'll start introducing higher value distractions like throwing toys or throwing treats on the floor. If the dog breaks command to go and get it, remote goes on, working level, continuous stim. And at that point, you've already taught the dog how to shut stim off. So they're like, oh, I wasn't supposed to get out of command yet because you didn't say the release word. And you'll see the dogs just go right back and do what they were supposed to do. So it's like, so you do know you just wanted that thing more than you wanted to stay in command.
Right.
So then that's how we start really proofing it. And that's how you start getting dogs to hold commands for a very long period of time.
Right.
And so you release them.
I think a lot of the proofing stage that we do actually looks like we're teasing the dog, but all we're doing is simulating the real world. Because just think about your dog being at a downstate in an outdoor cafe. How many people are going to, you know, like walk up to your dog and do kissy face and bend down and trying to get your dog's attention? And
literally every day.
And how many kids are going to come by on scooters and skateboards and bouncing balls, and how many dogs are going to walk by and little toddlers running by? And
that's if you actually want to like do things with your dog.
Right. I think
there's some people who might,
they don't want to,
just don't do that stuff.
Right. But we'll talk about like even problems in the house that a remote collar can help eliminate. So then now we're getting a dog and we're spending a couple of weeks on that, but we're doing it like in so many different environments that really, really help the dog understand it. So now when we have a dog that absolutely knows the command, if it doesn't do the command, it knows when it feels the stim to do the command, okay, without us having to say it. It'll actually know to do it. So that's when you know a dog is actually pretty proficient on the remotes.
Yeah.
And then when we have a dog that is introduced to different distractions, and if they do break command, and if they do feel the remote, they're actually going back into command. So now you have a dog that actually understands
the language.
So now, after doing that enough times, enough places, you know, with enough environmentals, okay, you know the language now.
And you pretty much, you'll see it, like you'll get to a point where, you know, in the beginning you are holding that button continuously for a few seconds while the dog's kind of like, what the heck am I supposed to be doing?
Right.
And you show them. But you get to the point where like you barely have time to press that button and they're running back. It's like,
right.
They know.
I mean, I think the best example is back when the lunchroom was in the office, we have two huge windows that look onto the training floor.
Yep.
And we would have, say, 10 dogs all in, say, a down or in place. And then we would bring all the remotes in and say one dog sat up and just a small tap of that remote, the dog would literally just lie back down. Mm-hmm. So like, that's not something that the dog just innately is going to do out of the blue. Like it knows, like it's been trained.
It knows.
It's been trained. It's at the level now where it's been trained. So then when do we go to correction level on the remote and what does that look like?
We only go to correction when like that example, like when we feel confident enough that like when we tap that button or hold it, but it's really, it's very short, the dog does exactly what it's supposed to do with zero of our help. We're not giving it a verbal cue. We're not moving closer to help with spatial pressure. We're not repeating commands. It's like dog's in a down stay 5 feet away from me. It gets up. I hit that pressure and the dog immediately lays back down without any interference from me.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know exactly what you're supposed to do.
Right.
We can probably move you to corrections at this point.
Right.
And that's with distractions, distance, and building and duration at the same time.
So, and then when they do break a command, a known command, and we do say no, and then we deliver the correction, it's definitely at a higher level. And what level is a higher level?
That's so dependent on the dog, right? People hear high level and they assume like 100, right? But it's like, no, like we have dogs that if they work on a 5, 15 might be high to them.
Right.
Like it's all relative to the dog. So I think when people hear high level correction, it scares them a little bit because they just assume that means the highest possible level.
Right.
It's not the case for obedience, especially like, if you break it down, say, I want it to be a level that you feel and that you're not going to do it again, but right. I don't want you like hitting the ceiling and because you felt that remote.
Right.
It's just like, hey, don't do that again.
Right.
That's it.
Now, there are instances. I just did a phone consult today with a client whose dog is fully off-leash trained. They went through our board and train program and they have a couple of cats. And the dog is wanting to chase the cats. And what they're doing, though, is when the cat walks by, the dog goes to break the command or does break the command a little bit. They do say no. They do hit the button on the remote. The dog does go back, but it's doing it every day.
So it's just nagging.
So what I told them is, what number are you working at? And we know their dog, and the dog actually works at higher levels.
Mm-hmm.
So the number that they're working at is sort of like the kindergarten stage.
Yep.
So your dog's already trained. It's past the kindergarten stage. So I said, you need to go much higher. And I gave them a number and it was pretty, you know, it was above 50, which sounds like a lot, but for this particular
dog,
it's not a lot. And for a lot of dogs, it's not a lot actually. So, but it absolutely needs to be corrected. Meaning, yeah, that was a little bit uncomfortable. I think we need to start talking. Nobody wants to talk about that. It's like, yes, you are actually making it uncomfortable, but you're also talking about a dog that you've been putting a lot of time in and a lot of reps. And actually you don't want to every day keep like having to repeat yourself. You want a level of expectation with your dog that it's going to know and, you know, stick the commands just so you can have that. You can, because we're looking for reliability, whether it's off leash or on leash. I want that dog to be reliable and I don't want that dog to break no matter what the environmental is. So I think it's important that people do understand. It's like, yeah, corrections are uncomfortable as they should be. So
nobody likes a nag. I think that's one thing I say the most at go home sessions with clients is like, how many times do you want to remind your dog not to do this?
Right.
Every day,
especially when he knows it.
And you know, for a lot of owners, like, well, I don't like correcting my dog. I'm like, I don't like correcting your dog either. So do you want to correct them multiple times every day for the rest of their life? Or do you want to get one good correction in and be done with it?
Right. And nobody likes, I mean, I've seen, you know, obviously there's a lot of negativity around this whole industry and me especially. And a lot of people are like, he loves correcting dogs. I'm like, no, I don't. I don't know too many people. Actually, I don't know of anybody personally that enjoys correcting their dog. I do. The only thing I like about correcting a dog is I know what's on the other side of that correction, mm-hmm. which is a happier family, a family that can do more things with their dog, and a dog that actually listens and stops breaking command a lot. as far as in the obedience ring. Not like the performance ring, but in the realm of obedience. That's the only thing I like about that is that, and I'm doing it with a dog that actually knows a command. Mm-hmm. So I think that's really, really important. So that's the short version on, because this takes, you know, we're talking about hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of reps.
Yeah.
And it's with also multiple trainers because we want the dog to listen to, you know, all the people that work there. And then the owner gets obviously lots of training, but someone's got to do the laborious reps. There's no escaping that. So I think that's where it's a shortcut. I think when someone says it's a shortcut, I mean, that's a really convenient cut and paste false thing. There's a lot of cut and paste, you know, responses to a lot of dog training. And there's a lot of these, you know, comments that people make that are just like canned responses that you keep seeing over and over and over again.
It's literally the same stuff. Don't train with pain.
Right. And it's just like, well, we also have to put context into that as well. There actually is a time to use discomfort in probably every category of life, but especially in dog training. I mean, you're working with an apex predator here.
They're animals.
They inflict
pain on each other on like a daily basis.
But also it's like sometimes the lack of that, they're going to, you know, suffer pain anyway through a consequence that Mother Nature is going to, you know, put down on your dog. So that's the realm of like the obedience, you know, the basic obedience commands that we have. So number one, you're not just pushing a button. There's a lot of prep work. We use a lot of food. You know, that doesn't mean you have to, but there's a ton of reward based stuff that leads up to everything because you are teaching, you know, you want to motivate your dog because you want
your words to be powerful. Mm. Like you want your commands to have a positive association to them.
Right. Right.
You want work to suck.
Right.
Like,
so I think it's really, really important that,
and that's like, while we're on that topic, that's another big thing. I'm a huge, huge stickler at go home sessions when clients, they're nervous, you know, they want to get their timing in right. Let's say the dog breaks command. They just go right to that button. I'm like, you better say no, because if you don't say no before a correction, all you're doing is now making your commands hot.
Right.
They'll be like place. And then the dog doesn't go. They hit the button. It's like, you just said place equals a correction.
Right.
That is the worst thing you could possibly do. So markers. Anytime you're going to correct your dog, you got to get a no or whatever marker you want it to be. You could be 9 if you train in German or whatever, right. But
it doesn't, yeah, whatever no it is.
Before the correction.
Right.
It is so important.
Right. Just like you're saying yes before and the that's reward.
So why on the NCS stage, we actually don't say no because we're on such low working levels. We just want that word place, let's say is the command, and then they don't go. So I'll do sim. I just want that to be a bridge to do what you were supposed to do. I don't want it to be a correction yet.
Right.
I just want them to be like place. And then, oh, I feel something. How do I shut it off? Mm. Oh, right. Go over to that bed. I don't want it to become hot or anything like that at that point because they're still learning.
Right. Now let's talk about behavior mod, which is what we do a lot of. And I enjoy it the most because what we're doing is we're preventing the dog from usually being killed, put down, or given away. You know, and I enjoy the stopping of unwanted behaviors a lot because it's the most satisfying thing that I get because I know I'm helping the owner out tremendously where they've tried so much and nothing has really, really helped. So there's a couple of, you know, this whole conversation that remote cowers create these bad behaviors. All I can tell you is that the dogs are presenting the bad behaviors to me. I didn't create them. Like, you came to me with these bad behaviors. So like, you came to me being dog aggressive, people aggressive. You came to me having massive separation anxiety. You came to me breaking out of crates. Like, we didn't train you to do that or make you do that. So that's really, really, really important. You know, a lot of folks, and I think even in the literature on some of the remote cowers, and it's probably just possibly from their legal department, don't use these on aggressive dogs. And just to let folks know that a remote cower is one of the best tools out there for aggressive dog rehab. It's a fantastic tool out there to do. But Let's talk about now when in the behavior mod realm, which is stopping unwanted behaviors. So let's talk about act of God stuff first, because we'll just get that out of the way. So there are maybe six things that a dog does that we just doesn't, you don't really need much training at all. You can go right to a high level and it doesn't mess up the dog at all. And you can actually go to stopping unwanted behaviors first at high levels and then go back to what Joelle just described that she did. So the dog doesn't need to be conditioned on the remotes at all. The dog can go right to putting the remote on and stopping it. It's the same thing as a bark collar. The dog barks, it feels discomfort, it stops barking because they connect the dots. So I think that's really important. But there's a couple of things such as jumping up on counters, counter surfing. There is getting into the trash. There is getting into the litter box. There is digging holes.
Eating poop,
barking out the front window, rushing the front door. And I think, you know, is there any more that I'm missing?
Did you say digging holes?
Digging holes, yeah. You know, any barking at all, like barking.
Eating random stuff off the floor.
Right. You know, being in the car and barking, you know, when you run into, you know, the grocery store or 7-Eleven or whatever, and the dog is going nuts, or you're at a gas pump and the person next to you and the dog goes nuts at. So, but a lot of it is just like, I mean, some of it is like life-saving stuff, like counter surfing and getting in the trash. That's life-saving stuff. Your dog could actually die. There are many dogs that, you know, that ingest things off counters or from the trash. They literally have to go in for surgery if they even make it. I mean, your dog, you could come home to a dead dog. Now, those are, how do you get it? I'll just give one example. How do we stop? And we've done it thousands of times. And people that we do consults with have done it. People that hear our podcast have done it. And the dogs stop doing it. Literally after 1 to 2 sessions. We're talking about people have been trying to stop counter surfing sometimes for months or years, or have just totally given up, or they just like, sure, when you have a dog, you sort of have to dog-proof your home a little bit. But to think that, like, I'm looking at our counter right now, there's like a pineapple, flowers, your bag that you just went grocery shopping with, Angelo's power bars, there's a loaf of bread, peanut butter, fresh fruits, and often, you know, your sunglasses are up there and your cell phone might be up there. And then there's also like you like to go to the beach. So you've got all your tanning. There's like a lot of tanning solutions up there that are in bottles. So, you know, to think that I've got to remove all that stuff at all times, it's ridiculous. Instead, why don't we just teach our dogs to not go up there? So what you do is this. You put something really, really yummy on the counter, like a sandwich or a steak, something you know the dog is actually going to jump up the counter. So what we're doing is we're actually setting the dog up to fail. Okay?
Those evil words.
Yep. We have to. It's like, we want you to do the bad behavior. Well, first of all, you do the bad behavior anyway. But even if the dog didn't, you can still train the dog not to do it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, well, my dog never jumps up on the counter. I'm like, well, let's make sure. Let's make sure that the dog still continues to never jump up on the table.
Like people who do rattlesnake avoidance training, it's like you sort of do that as a preventative.
You don't
wait until the dog goes after a rattlesnake.
Right, right.
You
so
do it before.
So then what we do is we will leave the room, and you can actually set your remote collar to tone if you want to. Now, there are some things we just went over. It's important to say no. There are many times where I actually won't say anything, but the act of getting up on the counter becomes very hot.
It's like the correction comes from nowhere. That's why we call it the act of God correction. Because no humans are present, technically.
Right. So then what we do, getting the dishwasher is another one.
Yeah.
So then what we do is, I'm sorry, eating socks, getting in the laundry basket.
I said that. I don't think you heard me though.
Okay.
But yeah.
So, I mean, I think there's just think about all these just bad behaviors that are dangerous to your dog, or your dog won't stop. But are not obedience. It's not obedience at all. It's more of on the behavior realm, bad behavior realm. So, dog gets up on the counter and you can either be looking through a window or looking through a little, you know, camera system. And we go to the highest level on the remote and we hold the remote down for a good amount of time. How long? usually 5 seconds plus. The dog comes off the counter in about a split second. So why do you have to keep going? Well, same philosophy as underground fence. When the dog goes through the fence, a lot of times now the new technology is that the cow, even though the dog has cleared the fence, the collar is still activated because they want the dog, they don't want the dog escaping the fence. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I want it to really, I want it to really, really suck to jump on that counter. I want you to remember today that today was a horrific experience to you. Now, I'm not going to destroy my dog. I'm not going to ruin the relationship with my dog. I'm not going to mess up my dog. What I'm going to do is teach my dog that jumping up on the counter is a really, really bad experience. Same with getting in the trash, getting the litter box, the laundry basket. Dogs ingest clothing, socks and underwear. You know, they love dirty diapers, but socks and underwear, and they could die. Mm-hmm. They could easily die. So that's where that narrative about the high corrections you should never use. And I'm like I said, we need a little bit of context here. Like, what's the context? So you absolutely should. Fence fighting. Mm-hmm. Fence fighting is another one.
Yep.
So I think it's important that, and the biggest thing again is you're not once are you yelling, screaming, mad, upset. You're never saying bad dog. You're not giving it a timeout. You're not like doing any of that stuff. I think
the lack of tools leads to frustration.
It absolutely does.
Build a really bad relationship with your dog because you're just frustrated. You're angry. Oh, this freaking dog destroying my life. Yeah. La, la, la. Yeah. It's like, you're so much easier to be if you could just knock all that crap out.
I remember, you know, when I was, my dogs are pretty much naked right now. And we can talk about like, when can the dog be off the remote? And, you know, naked meaning they don't wear a remote. But, you know, when I was first training them, before I got into remote collar work, If I was that one that would like, if I yelled at my dog for doing something wrong, my dogs looked terrified.
Mm-hmm.
They looked terrified. But once I went to remote, they didn't look terrified. They stopped their unwanted behavior. They didn't exactly enjoy it when they were corrected for something, but they didn't look afraid of me.
It's neutral.
They look afraid of me because I just said, no.
Right.
That's it. I didn't have to raise my voice, deepen my voice, you know.
Get in their space.
So to me, it's just like, no, it's just, again, that's your marker. And then consequence comes after that. Because we really want the word no to have meaning behind it.
Exactly.
So I think it's important that folks understand, it's like, why do we use the certain tools that we use? Because we want the word no to actually be pretty powerful. We really want it to be powerful. So now when it comes to like, I think a big thing is racing the front door, which I think is really dangerous to do. I think it's a great tool to use. So a lot of people are grabbing their dogs, holding them back, which actually frustrates them. And actually, that's a great way to actually increase the behavior mm-hmm. and to put your dog into drive. So you, again, make the rush to the front door suck. Make rushing the barking out the front windows suck. Make fence fighting suck. So I think it's important that people understand that it's like, but we're talking about out of the 86,400 seconds in a day, we're talking about just a small window of time in the dog's life. And we're also talking about like, it's not a daily thing where teaching obedience, it's like, yeah, it's actually a long, long, long process.
And you don't have to... Like, I know you have a lot of people who do consults with you and they're like, my dog is fence fighting or my dog is eating things and I've had to have 2 surgeries already, but I haven't conditioned it to a remote yet. Like,
well, for eating socks, and that's why I have to rush to the emergency room. And just, you know, after, even though you've paid $4,500 for the surgery, the dog, and if the dog doesn't die before surgery or die on the table or get infected afterwards and you have to go in for more surgery, the dog still didn't learn not to eat socks.
No, but that's what I'm saying. I feel like that's the big thing out there is like, oh, you can't do those high corrections until the dog knows what the remote means.
No, you don't. You can do them right off the bat.
Right.
You can do them on day one.
Right.
Because a lot of the consults that I do, it's a 30-minute consult and maybe they don't want to obedience train their dog mm-hmm. on a remote. Okay, fine. Which is stop unwanted behaviors. And I can stop them from far away too, which is another great thing. And then all of a sudden they're like, wow, this remote thing is pretty cool. What else can I do with it? You can actually, you know how your dog can never be off leash? You know how you say you want to go hiking with your dog and you want to go on the beach with your dog? You know how you say you want to like see your, Jeff, I see your dog swimming in the ocean. I'd love to be able to do that. I'm like, well, you better have a good recall, not just on land, but actually you better be able to have a recall in the water. Because a lot of my dogs, sometimes if they, a ball, unfortunately, sometimes a chucket ball will have a hole in it, or a ball will have a hole in it and it sinks. And some of my dogs that have got huge ball and hunt drive, they won't stop looking for it. So after a while, it's like, and I know the ball is gone. It's like, you've got to recall them back. Mm-hmm. So here you have a dog now that like, all they want to do is find the ball. It's all they want to do. But it's like, I got to actually break that from you. So I've got to call them back. And if they don't come back, that's where the remote collar comes in handy. And they need to also know what that means. Right. So I think it's important that people understand that. Let's talk about separation anxiety and state of mind, because we talk a lot about state of mind, because there's a difference between a dog physically doing a command and then mentally doing a command. And a lot of times people, they'll see the dogs in a lot of our photos and they say, oh, look, they look shut down. And I'm like, they're not shut down. They're fully relaxed. But if we said break and then we ran out, you know, outside to go play, they'd be fine. Or if we just said break, they'd be like, yeah, all right, that's great. So I think it's important to be like, okay, class, sit down at your desks and stop talking and pay attention. Or it's time to, you know, take a nap. Mm-hmm. Or I don't want to have to exercise my dog so much that they're tired and they just fall asleep on their own. I want to be like, yesterday we had a humongous, humongous thunderstorm here, but it only lasted for half an hour down mm-hmm. in Florida. But when we're in New England, it would rain for days.
Yep.
You know, it's just like, well, I'm not running out in this, you know, right now. Or a massive snowstorm, you're actually snowed in. So you can maybe shovel out an area of your yard that's big enough for the potty yard, but, you know, going for a walk just isn't practical, or it's not safe on the streets. Mm-hmm. There's been many times at the training center where staff, you can't walk the dog because not only is the sidewalk covered, but the two-lane street is, you know, they only plowed it wide enough for one car. So I actually don't want you walking on the street, you know, in a slippery condition, you know, with the dog.
Right.
So I think it's really important that remote collars don't ruin relationships. If anything, they build relationships.
It's better because you actually like can do stuff with your dog.
Mm. So let's talk about state of mind. So I think it's important that people understand that a lot of people right now have got a lot of nervous, fearful, anxious dogs. We're seeing a lot of that right now.
Tons.
Believe it or not, a remote collar is probably going to be your best friend.
Mm-hmm.
We get dogs that are literally, we actually get dogs that come to us that are pretty quote unquote shut down, and the remote collar actually adds energy to them.
Yeah.
But also when you get a dog that is always anxious, always like on alert, say in a crate, or just even sitting down, it can never relax. It's always in the car, it can never relax. Well, a remote collar can actually help that dog. It's just relax. What you're doing is, again, it's a conversation piece. So we have dogs. In a lot of our seminars is the best example. We'll have 20 dogs there. Some of them have never been in a crate. Some of them don't even know down. And within about 5 to 10 minutes, we can get every single dog to lie down with its head down and just be calm next to a bunch of other dogs. And it's not from blasting them. That's another thing that people have got to understand.
Yep.
It's like most of this work is done at low levels.
Mm-hmm.
How low? The dog will tell us, but it's done at low levels. Very rarely are you, I mean, if you have a dog though that is like trying to break out of a crate, well, you're stopping that with a high level, but then getting the dog to lie down and relax, that's at a low level. And we have videos showing us doing that. We do it all the time. Our clients do it all the time. You know, how do you guys teach the double down? You know, there's, I've seen some videos out there against us saying, you know, they're just nailing these dogs at a high level. And it's like, actually, the video that we put out showing it shows it with a very low level. And it's like, we're actually demonstrating it on a dog, like mm-hmm. the dog's right there. And like, and I preach that. And I've always preached that. So I'm not quite sure where people get this information. So I think it's really, really important that it's funny because you were talking about you want to do a show this, like, people are losing their critical thinking. And I'm like,
they are.
But we can, Joelle, this is Real Talk with Jeff and Joelle. We can talk about anything on our show. So yeah,
we'll save that for another episode.
We'll do another episode about just, it's not going to just be probably not just about dogs at some point. It's going to actually transition into a lot of things, a lot of things, and more about, you know, the whole personal growth, learning, thing. We're not going to, I don't think we're going to be talking about current events. You know, I think it's going to be just about like how people consume information and how people make their decisions. And it's like, it's interesting how people are making their decisions these days. So for separation anxiety, it's actually the most wonderful thing in the world, because dogs that have got separation anxiety are always often biting the crate, digging the crate, pushing against the crate, barking and whining. That we see that a lot. Well, the remote collar can stop all that.
Mm-hmm.
It can stop every one of those things. We historically stop separation anxiety in a day.
Yeah.
Historically.
Sometimes it lingers, but yeah, most of the time.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think that that's really, really important that people understand.
The biggest part of separation anxiety is you have to be able to address the behavior when you're not home. And how do you do that without a tool that allows you to?
Right. So a lot of times we'll tell people, it's like, well, you've got your video camera on, you get in your car, you pull actually out of your driveway because dogs know when the car is there.
Yep.
And you actually can park, you know, one or two houses down. The video still works and the remote collar still reaches, and you actually can like start to work then.
Mm-hmm.
So it's training. Like it's training. It's not in, like separation anxiety historically is not an easy fix.
No.
There's people that struggle with it for years. There's people that actually have rehomed their dogs because of it. And these are dogs that are crated. An uncrated dog can destroy your home.
Break out of your house.
Like literally dogs break through the windows, and like I know many dogs that have come out of windows and chased their owners' cars down the street or gotten outside. There's dogs that, you know, also jumping fences. That's another thing that you can make is a very high correction. You make the act of jumping a fence, you know, suck, and that's done with a long line and the remote. There's so many things we can talk about here. So I think, you know, there's so much misinformation that, you know, we actually can help the dog. So in you know, a general statement that we can strongly make, because we see this every day, we can generally help the dog have a better state of mind. We can eliminate a lot of its anxiety and fear and nervousness. And it's not because dogs are being shut down. That is a lie. That's an outright blatant lie.
Yep.
We're actually getting them to relax.
Mm-hmm.
We're getting them to stop worrying about all these other things out there and to actually calm down. And we can do it actually really, really quickly. And the remote collar with no words is a wonderful thing.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful thing. And you can do it at a distance and you can do it remotely in one day because the technology is already out there. If you've got Wi-Fi and the remote collar picks up Wi-Fi and your handset picks up Wi-Fi and you've got a video camera, well, there's no reason why you can't just use the remote collar from anywhere in the world. And don't they have like treat dispensers now that can be used remotely?
And those cameras that you can like watch your dog on.
Right. So. And talk to your dog. Mm-hmm. So it's all done through Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
It's all done through Wi-Fi or through your data plan, you know? So I think it'll be there. And if there's anybody out there that wants to spend some time and resources on that, the market would be huge.
Yeah.
The market would be huge on that. So, you know, that's a little bit of a dabble into remote collar training. I'm sure people are going to have a lot of questions, and we will have, you know, again, you can watch the Green to Graduate. We are going to be putting out another program that is going to be a support group for, it'll be a paid program, but it's a month-long program once a week with just people that are in the program that bought the videos asking troubleshooting questions.
Yeah.
But also, if you've got a lot of these questions about stuff, there's a couple of different ways that we have things. We do a weekly podcast, which is What Would Jeff Do with Jeff and Joelle. And it's historically Wednesdays at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And it's a great time to ask your questions. That's done through typing. But also, our Patreon channel. And all these links will be in the Academy link will be in the bio. Yeah. The Patreon link will be in the bio. And anything else we've talked about will be in the bio. And the Patreon channel is $10 a month. And that every week on Tuesdays, historically at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we do a Zoom room. it's a Q&A Zoom room. So that's face to face. So that's really great. And people can ask their questions and get answers. And it's a good mix of dog trainers and dog owners. And again, it's $10 a month.
Mm-hmm. And you can learn just from listening to other people's questions too, even if you don't actively engage. Yeah.
So many people have learned just through our being a fly on the wall or through our free content. Also, by being part of Patreon, another benefit is there's also videos that are on the channel. I mean, all the videos on the channel are not seeing anywhere else. It's the only platform you can see them on. But also, you also get 20% off of all of our courses and all of our consulting. Huge. So, like, if you bought one course, it would literally pay for your Patreon membership for the year. So why more people are not that smoothie place that we love to go to, that we'll probably go to later today.
Today's been my first day not getting a smoothie from there.
So we'll probably go later today. Like, they're like $8 a piece.
I've spent way too much money there.
Right.
Way too much money.
So, but they've got some great smoothies. Mm-hmm. We got some great smoothies. We'll put a link up to there. We'll put a link on there.
If you guys are in Florida.
Yeah, we'll put a link to them as well.
Bayshore Nutrition.
Yeah. So, what's it called again?
Bayshore Nutrition.
Yeah, and they're in Bradenton.
They're amazing.
Yeah, so a really nice couple owns it, and they've got great stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's you know, in closing, did you want to talk about anything at all?
I just think, like, you know, we can do a podcast for 5 hours talking about e-collar training, but it's a big difference between listening and doing. So if you guys are interested in actually learning and seeing it, the Green to Graduate course is going to be your resource for it all.
Right.
I mean, that's my favorite course we've put out. I've been wanting to make that course for years. We finally did it back in 2021. And it's just a really great course. Yeah. I mean, we break it all down. If you have a dog that is not trained, and you buy the course and you actually implement it, you will have a fully off-leash trained dog. There's people all over the world using it, and it's just so cool.
And, you know, a lot of trainers are actually also recommending it to their clients as well. So when you get a trainer that doesn't have a huge ego, they'll be like, okay, client, I know you're getting one-on-one training from me, but you know what? Also buy this course that Jeff and Joelle put out, because it just makes – it'll just give that trainer and client a better end result. And that is the goal.
Yeah.
Like, how can I help the client the best? It's like, well, there's a resource out there. You can do it, but I'll be your coach.
Right.
I'll be your coach and help you. So, but everybody also has different training styles too with the remotes. There are many people. Some people never use continuous. Some people do a series of tap, tap, tap. You know, we personally do. If we're in the learning stage, we do the pressure on, pressure off theory.
Yeah, we don't pump. Like, there's so many ways. That's the thing. Like, there are so many ways to e-collar train a dog. I just love our program.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah. And I think it's important. And, you know, this, again, this narrative that it messes up dogs, all I can say is I'm not seeing it. All I'm seeing is a lot of messed up dogs come to us.
And they just literally blossom. Like, it's incredible seeing the transformations.
Yes. I'm seeing nervous, fearful, anxious dogs come to us, and they literally become, you know,
functioning dogs.
Right.
Normal dogs.
Right. Every day. Mm-hmm. Like, tomorrow, I'm not sure when this podcast is going up, so probably the testimonial from Steve will probably already go up.
Yes.
But he's a client of ours who's owns a kickboxing gym in New York. And I've trained his first dog, who died of old age, and he just got another dog, and he brought him to his dog's at the gym every day. And you see him literally, like, there's like three classes going on, and there's sparring going on. Yeah. And there's like, you're like, holy shit. Cause it's MMA, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like, there's a boxing class, there's a grappling class, there's a kicking class. And like, this dog is literally lying down looking bored, but it's not bored. It's like just not being reactive.
I know. And he came in really insecure. And that's the thing. The biggest thing the owner said was like, I can't believe how much more confident he is now. He'd get scared of traffic. He'd get scared of this.
Right.
And this is a dog living in New York City. It's like, you can't be afraid of traffic.
Right.
So he got over it all. Like, that's the magic of what we do. We put these dogs through the program, and they're just like, they're like, let's go.
Yeah. I think it's really, really wonderful. And the great thing is, you know, we've got so many free videos up on our social media where we show our work.
Yeah.
And another thing we do show is we do show the messy parts. And I think sometimes people stick to see that and they just focus on that. And I'm like, well, all rehab is messy. There's always messy, no matter how you work the dog. And also a lot of these dogs came into us, they'd come to us pretty messed up.
Right.
They really, really do. And no fault of the owner at all. Mm-mm. A lot of them are just, was it nature or nurture? You know, sometimes it's a combination of both, but it's nobody that's intentionally messing up their dog. I don't think anybody intentionally messes up their dog.
Can't wait to spend $5,000 on a board and train.
Right, exactly. But I think what happens is they just, you know, a lot of owners just don't know. They just don't have the correct information. Mm-hmm. So the great thing I love about this new podcast we're doing is we're able to now even give people even more and more and more information. So that's fantastic. Anything else we want to do before we call it?
I think that's good.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah.
Well, Joelle, thank you so much. It's been a great, you know, episode number two. This is episode number two, Real Talk with Jeff and Joelle on remote power training.
Fancy equipment now, if you guys are watching on YouTube.
Yeah,
we got our new mics and our fancy headpieces now.
Yep, we got a little soundboard here.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah, we got a cute little.
I feel like I'm on a real radio show.
We got a soundboard here. So, you know, we could do all kinds of things now, and because it's time. It's time. I wanted to each have our own mics, and I wanted us to be able to do a lot of different things, So thank you, Joelle, for sitting down and you know, thank you for the awesome, fantastic input. Usually it's me just talking. So this is really, really, really great that we can start showcasing your knowledge because you're a highly skilled dog trainer and you're well-versed in troubleshooting and bluntly, you know your shit. So it's really, really great. You've gone toe-to-toe with the most aggressive dogs and you also have worked with the most happy-go-lucky puppies. So I think it's really, really fantastic. All right, everybody. Thanks so much. Love you all. All right. Bye-bye.